the universe presents trailheads, and you can choose to take it or not.
It's up to you whether you wake up to it and you do something with it.
I think that people who work hard are doing something wrong.
You often get the point where you don't quite know where to go, and I think the important thing is to continue to show up.
Thank God. This is my tutor right here.
That's one thing I got right. I knew that if I tried to do it by myself without input, I was a dead man.
But this is how I visualize. I visualize exactly as if it's happening now.
You don't wish, you know, I want to do this. It is.
Yeah, there's definitely been times when I felt like there would be no stopping me.
And what happens when you're in that zone is you start to feel like, oh God, how long will this last?
A lot of my thinking on mastery came from my study of Aikido. Every little attempt at overreaching or playing tricks to get better or trying to do a quick fix, they just don't work in Aikido.
I notice students who consistently excel follow five traits. I call these traits the five keys to mastery.
Watch out for that first step, it's a doozy.
I always wanted to be an actor as a kid because I thought that meant I would see Godzilla for real, that I would really fight wars and, you know, go to the moon and have adventures. But then as I got older, I enjoyed the craft of doing it.
I'd say most of the population, they can't even get the first key, which is figure out what it is you love. Figure out what it is that you want to do with your life, because basically what you do as a career is most of your waking hours. It defines you.
Most people, they're like, they live and die and they don't even know what was their calling. You know, I never found my calling, you know. Well, maybe you didn't take the time to push the pause button on yourself and really look at it.
So what do you want to know?
I want to know what happened.
We slept together.
Go look at me when I'm going to say the next thing, James, but I need an inner object of something that doesn't necessarily have to be a bad thing, but something you're embarrassed about if anybody were to know sexually about you.
We had sex. And you know what? That was it. That was it.
Keep the picture in your head. Keep the picture in your head. I work really hard. I love what I do. That makes me want to work hard. It's not drudgery for me. I look forward to it. I get up at 6 a.m. to work. No alarm clock. My body wakes me up. In the middle of the night, I may wake up with ideas and thoughts. I'm inspired by what I do.
The first greatest struggle as an actor is feeling that your dream will never come true, that no one believes in you and you'll never get a chance, that you got this bat and ball and they won't even let you on the playground to play. That's the first struggle. You end up, when you have that struggle, with a lot of friends, because there are a lot of other people who have new bats and balls that don't get on the playground either. And you end up sitting around drinking beers and talking about it at night. A lot of friends.
Be open vessel. You gotta be an open vessel in life, because whatever you shut down, you've also shut down possibilities.
The day-to-day activity of showing up in the lab, talking to people, exchanging ideas, formulating ideas is immensely satisfying. To sit down and think through the results of experiments and come up with some little idea is sensually extremely stimulating. It really is a wonderful intellectual sensuality that once one has experienced it, you don't want to let go.
Every experience that you have involves alterations in synaptic transmission.
and every mental process ultimately ought to be understood at this level.
I don't consider my career any more worthwhile than being a venture capitalist. The important thing is to use your imagination in an effective way.
What we do here for $25 million is what most people would probably do for $125 million. I mean, do you see how much was going on? That's a lot. You know, what we do is just, it's just too much. This place is the American dream. Some guy from Bowie, Maryland, with no money, who lived on fish subs, builds a business with a limited partnership, which is the only way a long-haired hippie can raise $500,000. I mean, we actually have a format in this country where people with no money, with a great idea, with orders, can get it. With, you know, in, they're investors. You know, people go, oh, you know, maybe he's got a shot. I'll put my money in, and we'll see how the money comes back. You know.
So you started with $500,000.
Yeah, a limited partnership. Mm-hmm. With investors, mm-hmm. You know, people who believed in the dream.
How did you learn about all this stuff?
One baby step at a time. How are you going to carve the top? What's the neck angle going to be? How thick's the guitar going to be? How are you going to dry the woods? How are you going to glue the woods together? How are you going to finish it? How are you going to buff it out? How are you going to get the inside corners? What kind of cases are you going to make? It just goes on and on and on and on and on and on. It's an art form.
So if you allow your thought process to run free, to have the freedom to go in whatever direction it's going to go, and you're going to end up in maybe inventing, whether it's the thought process or a Super Bowl or the theory of relativity, something that you didn't expect, and you get the unexpected. You get something much larger, something much more profound.
When you push the pause button, that's what happens to you. Because you see the big picture, and you see what you're supposed to do with your energy to affect black people in the planet in a grand way.
You gotta take a chance. You gotta jump and risk falling on your face. And you have to have had experience to know that if you fall on your face, you'll be okay.
It's a wonderful thing. I'm enormously grateful and feel privileged to get the Nobel Prize. But I didn't enter science in order to get the Nobel Prize. It's something that comes along the way. And my life, really, my professional life, is doing science. That gives me enormous pleasure.
Just to remind you, what we need to explain is how are vesicles restrained, how are they freed from the restraint, how are they targeted to the active zone, and once they reach the active zone, how is this magical moment of exocytosis achieved?
Test, check. Thank you, you too.
Live from the area's leading news station, this is News 4 at 5.
There's a new clue tonight in that helicopter crash in the Potomac.
Back in the late 70s even, was still part of the golden age of television journalism, of broadcast journalism. You now had these women who were in. And I, for some reason, because I guess I'd been in radio, I was still really hooked on radio news. I loved the idea of telling someone the news with language and sound and taking them there. I loved that.
As you begin to work, then the struggles you have are that you are not valued. You are not valued in what you do. Other people on the set are valued more than you. They'll call you in first thing in the morning. They won't work you until late afternoon. You're the last one to be dismissed from the set. They don't care about your time. They care about the other people's time. They'll just hold you around. You get your feelings stepped on a lot when you're not valued. That's the next stage that happens.
A lot of people, you think, oh, they don't know what they don't know. I knew what I didn't know, so it was really humbling for me to come into this business and be surrounded by these wonderful people practicing this craft and doing it so respectfully.
Everyone has Miles Davis, Charlie Parker, Einstein, Stravinsky in them, her or him. But can you pause your existence and look at it, crystallize your existence, and do something about it. Don't blame the white man. Don't blame the this. Don't blame the that, because you're too goddamn lazy to push the pause button.
Everybody gets gifts. Everybody. You know, my brother used to teach autistic children. And he said, even the most retarded kid would look down the road and Corvette. Literally 3 miles down the road, that kid could see it was, nobody could even see it was a car there. And this kid had like the vision of an eagle, right? It's gifted somehow. It happens. I think that our job is to know our place or figure out what our role is, and then to do that with some grace.
When you become more successful and you get more auditions than you lose, you get offers for parts where you don't even have to audition. That's awfully nice. Then the problem you have is you lose your friends. You don't have those friends anymore. Now you have people who are jealous. They feel that you have more success than you deserve. You have their career. You have to deal with kind of the loneliness of that. And then you find that you have always a true friend in your passion, and you have more time to put into your love of acting or music or whatever. You realize that you have a very true companion in your passion, and then it all feels much better.
What role do you play? Because everyone's significant, everyone's supremely important. You know, it's not like Sally's the smart one and Bertha's the dumb one. You know, no, everyone has the capacity for excellence and grandness. God doesn't just give it to the few, He gives it to everybody. It's up to you whether you wake up to it and you do something with it.
Practice is the magic formula. That's what's magic. There are a lot of other things about it. Talent is important, but not nearly as important as is practice.
The most important trait you need is tenacity. I've seen a lot of people in a workout try something once or twice and it doesn't work, and they sort of kind of get it in their mind that they can't do it, and the third or fourth time it might work. And I've had a lot of workouts where I wasn't able to do a move, and then it gets, you know, a week later it's the race and I do it okay in the race anyway, simply because I tried it a whole bunch of times and didn't let myself get down.
You've got to be willing to spend most of your time on a plateau where you don't seem to be learning very much, a long time. Now then suddenly, after a long time on the plateau, you have a little spread upward. Suddenly you get better. Over a period of days or weeks, you're suddenly making these great improvements. Ah, at last I'm learning. Wrong. They are not learning in the spread upward. They are learning while they're on the plateau.
They needed someone to do news on a radio station in Norfolk, Virginia back in 1976. And I went and auditioned as an actress pretending to be a newscaster, and I got the job. And then reading the news over and over again, you just get it.
This is my big break. Don't ruin it for me, Jack.
I was dating a guy who was 10 years older than me, Wayne Price. He was 30, a lawyer. I was 19, about to turn 20. And I was at a party with him, with his older lawyer friends, and I was essentially arm candy. They were talking about the OPEC oil crisis, and they were wrong. And I knew it because I had read it a million times on the air, over and over again. I was just reading it. And I'm listening to them have this discussion, and I thought, they're wrong. That's not why the guy's doing it. That's not at all why he's doing it. He's doing it because of this. I just got it through osmosis, and I, and I spoke up. I had never joined into the conversations because I was too shy and I was intimidated by these lawyers, but I spoke up. I said, no, that's not why he did it. The whole problem with the cartel is that da-da-da-da. So now he's saying they need this, blah, 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 blah. And I said, that's why, because of this and this and this and this. I wasn't happy that I knew this. I just knew it, you know, I knew it. And they turned and looked at me like the blonde speaks. And I thought, yeah, the blonde speaks. And I know what I'm talking about. You're wrong. I thought, what a concept, information.
How much time a day do you just sort of sit and think about the problem?
Well, it varies. It depends on, you know, whether there's an interview going on. You can't, you know, you think about it, you know, when you shower, when you shave. So, I mean, I have no idea. I don't sit down, you know, I'm going to think now. I mean, you know, it's a little bit like being a parent. It's a reflex.
Everything that happens to you affects the communication between nerve cells. It affects it transiently in some cases. A lecture like this, you probably want to forget this after an hour or two. But in other cases, in a more enduring fashion. And there, elaborations of the mechanisms I'm going to describe to you occur.
I think the important thing is to take your ideas seriously, to try to develop them in your own head, to be critical about them, not to fall in love with your ideas, because most ideas turn out to be wrong. But I think one has to get pleasure out of the moment-to-moment aspects of the career. The rest takes care of itself.
Don't feel that the little things you have to do day to day are distancing you from your dream. Everything brings you closer to your dream. It's just a mindset.
We are practicing all the time. Did you ever go to a dinner party and there are 8 people at the dinner party and 7 of them are talking happily about some positive things they could do with their community, but diner number 8, he'll say, wait a minute, can't you see that will never work? Point A, point B, point C. You wonder how the hell he got so good at it. He's been practicing that for 40 years. He's been practicing being negative for 40 years.
Harold Ramis said to me, now we've set the camera up here and Bill is going to punch you, but he ain't going to come that close. I said, well, where do you want me to end up after the punch? And he goes, what do you mean? I said, well, I can do a dancer's turn and stop wherever the camera is. I mean, if it's here, if it's there, or if it's there, I could do a turn. And he says, you can do that? I said, well, sure. I learned it in dance class in college. You know, just tell me where you want me to stop. He says, well, end up looking at the courthouse down there at the other part of the square. That'll be great for us. So the first take, Bill punched me, stopped there, fell on the mat they had from the ground. That's the one they used.
Most people take the path of least resistance. It's easier just to accept the things that have happened to you and accept that more of the same is going to happen to you, and that's just the way it is. That's the way most people deal with life. Then there's that really tiny little path filled with all kinds of rocks and jungle and snakes and rats and all kinds of horrors. But those are people that they decide to overcome all those barriers, the hurdles, the obstacles, the conflicts that get in your way, that I am in fact not only going to try to overcome those, but I'm going to use those. Say that person following that, I don't have any food, but I'm going to eat that rat instead of letting that rat hurt me. I'm going to eat it and make it nourish me. And I am going to overcome these things, these barriers that have been presented to me in my life. And that makes me someone that is going to not only prosper in a large way, but I have a sense of satisfaction in the fact that I did it.
Raw willingness makes up for, I mean, some people are a genius. They don't have to work for it. It just oozes out of them. But sometimes a guy who's not as genius as this person can beat this guy up because he has more raw willingness than this guy to do something with it.
I think one of the things that makes me very happy is that I feel like I'm doing something worthwhile.
This is a set of changes for doing something.
Wow. I think that people who work hard are doing something wrong. I don't work long hours. I play around with the computer a lot. It just takes a lot longer than you think, which is actually very good, because if you realized how long it takes to get to the end, you'd never get anything done because you just give up in disgust. So you actually need to like the details, because if you don't like the details, you'll never get anywhere.
Before I do a film, I make sure I know the film backwards and forwards to begin with. And I make sure I know 2 or 3 weeks ahead of time all the lines I need to know for about the first 2 days of work.
In order to achieve one's goals, there has to be a serious level of dedication, not just verbal dedication, you know, like when people say, you know, I'm really dedicated to this project, and they're not, you know, and then they spend their nights out partying, and then the next day they don't do it because, you know, they're hungover or whatever. I mean, for me, this is like 24 hours a day.
When I come home from working on that, I look at my script again to make sure I know what's happening the next day, and I go to bed and try to have as much sleep as I possibly can for the next day. As little fooling around as possible, as little booze as possible, as much sleep as possible when I'm working. When I'm not working.
You have to be willing to be a fool, too. That's part of it. The glorious fool. The fool is a learner. The fool is open to new ideas and is willing to take chance and willing to look foolish. You've got to be willing to look foolish to really be a master.
Wendy Rieger, poofs her hair.
All right, so did you get that script yet?
I think it's okay to have a little nervous breakdown once in a while. I think it's okay to say, you know what? I'm gonna be lazy. I'm gonna be a car up on cinder blocks for a while because I need this. I need to check out, but I need this paycheck.
I get really bored not having anything to do, right? I have other things I like doing. But for example, I'm a bad father. I get so bored going to like soccer games. I'm like standing there, and I'm sorry. It's my kid running around chasing a ball, and I'm sure she finds it interesting, or I hope she finds it interesting. But to me, it's like I'm just saying, can't I go back? Can't I go back to work?
When I go out, I make sure that I look good all the time. Why? Because I have to. I have to live the part. Number one, 5 meals a day. I have to eat to maintain the body that I need to do this. I need to be strong because it's very tiring. Constantly eating to keep my metabolism going. And sometimes it's hard because you're not always hungry. Of course, in the morning, got to do the whole skincare regimen, you know, make sure your skin is flawless. 9 o'clock, I check in with my agency. See what I have going for the day. Exercise, that is the practice right there, living what you're doing. It's me, you know, it's what I am, it's what I do, it's what I love.
A mark of the master is one who not only is willing to stay on a plateau over a long period of time and keep training diligently, but to love the plateau, to cherish the plateau, to even say, fine, I'm on a plateau now. If I stay on this plateau, I am destined to have the jump upward.
For me, the best part of a kayaking workout is nailing a move. I love nailing a move. You have a surf on a wave to coming into a gate in an eddy and coming back out onto another wave. And when you do it fast, a second faster than you've ever done it before, and you beat everybody else's time and it feels so good, it's the highlight of your life.
Let it torment you and don't let him do it. You're letting him win.
I did something wrong, all right? I thought she was, you know, she was being a little prudish. She needed a little coercion.
The way I teach how to act, it's about creating the journey that will allow you resolution in some very profound pain area. That then the process of actually acting becomes a catharsis as opposed to just emotionalizing, which I think ends up hurting everybody. It's like watching somebody wear their emotions on their sleeve. It's hard to be around them. And so, but that person who has those emotions and those feelings and those pains and they're trying to do something about it are very powerful, heroic people. So to watch that journey of somebody, whether it's in life, trying to overcome huge obstacles of Martin Luther King, of being a black man in the South, Stephen Hawkins, who is essentially, for all intents and purposes, entirely handicapped, you know, and yet he accomplished huge things, but why? Because they took their pain and their circumstances and they used that to fuel their mission, and thereby that it became such a strong fuelant that it actually created greatness. And that's what I teach people how to do in their work.
In shooting, there's very little natural talent. I believe that you have to develop your skill, and that takes a lot of rounds downrange and a lot of hours, you know, practicing. There's also mental training and there's also physical training, and I think all of those three things combined are what really develop your skill to be an elite athlete.
Diligent, patient, long-term practice, and you'll be okay.
And I find that if your body is there physically, if everything is working properly and you're very strong, you're very confident, and your body is in like top condition, I find that then your mind will follow.
It didn't matter, you know, how short or how tall I was or how fast I could run. It was like how hard I could concentrate.
Practice.
Work your ass off.
Practice.
One baby step at a time.
Practice.
You cannot take no for an answer.
Practice.
Willingness.
Dedication.
Tenacity.
Practice, practice, practice.
You often get the point where you don't quite know where to go. And I think the important thing is to continue to show up.
Bing!
What are you practicing? See? What if you're practicing wrong? Then you get very good at doing something wrong. So it's a pretty good idea to have a teacher.
As Tony Bennett says, if you take from one person, it's called stealing. If you take from many, it's called research. My father was my first teacher. My father taught me charisma just by being around him, because people really adore my dad. You know, every time he played, oh, Don Jose, you know, all the women and the children were like after him, you know, play me this song. So he would, and he made contact, you know, he played the violin and he make eye contact with you and then you just light up, you know. But my dad had charisma, my mom had conviction. Oh, it's just raw conviction. So I put it all together, you know. It was just a matter of like, you know, to take what you need from B.B. King, Peter Green, or Eric Clapton, or Jimi Hendrix, or, you know, Albert King, all the kings. And then once you take everything from them, then you spend time in the dark shedding yourself away from them.
This poison is so deadly that you need to be a specialized chef in Japan in order to deal with pufferfish, so you can dissect out the salivary gland without releasing the tetrodotoxin, so you kill neither yourself nor the people that eat the pufferfish.
Most good scientists who have
not only is this
good
deadly,
labs have spectacular students. And those students don't simply come to learn, but they come often having trained at different places with expertise that you do not have.
I believe that I, as an educator, should never stop learning. And in fact, if I do stop learning and stop exploring and discovering new information and ways to educate and information that I use to educate with, then shoot me, I shouldn't be doing it anymore.
Anybody who's made it to the top of their game has got encyclopedias of information. They have studied and studied and studied and studied.
I didn't finish high school. And however popular I get now, I've been very popular through the years as a disc jockey into a musician, blues singer. I still missed the education that I didn't get. So I'm continuously, this is one of my teachers here, I'm continuously trying to catch up.
Tell everybody! B.B. King's in town.
Kids come up to me, you know, and B.B. so-and-so and a lot of things I really don't know. So they think, you know, I should know, maybe I should. B.I., you do so-and-so. So if it's a few things, technique on the guitar, I can tell them. But other than that, I'm ashamed to go and ask somebody else how you do, so thank God. This is my tutor right here.
Important teachers, two in college that were important, one for a negative reason, one for a positive reason. The negative reason was a teacher by the name of Joan Potter. She was in college, she was a college acting teacher, and for some reason she had it out for me. I don't know why exactly, but she ended up having me kicked out of the professional acting curriculum at SMU. So I took kind of general classes my first 2 years, and then she basically said to the faculty, I'm not teaching this guy. He should not be in the acting curriculum. He's out of here. My advisor told me, I'm sorry, but you haven't been accepted in the professional acting curriculum. And I was enormously depressed because it was my only dream. And then I thought in my head, I said, you know, I'm paying these guys their salary. They're not paying me. I'll take whatever course I want to take. So I signed up for the advanced acting classes anyway, and I showed up in class. No one would teach me. They would not call on me. They would not give me tests. They would not give me scene assignments, and I showed up day after day after day.
If something happens bad to you, at least blah, 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 you know, and I always find it's like, well, it's like someone, you know, had a problem with their relationship with their man. He's been fooling around. I say, well, now you have something to use in your work when you have this kind of a part, you know, or whatever. Or now you've learned what not to do, or now you learned, you know, what you shouldn't do, what you shouldn't accept in the future, or how that lie turned into such a huge thing that you know that you can, that this is something that you can use as information to be a, to grow and be a better actor and person. And so you could always take anything that happens, no matter how bad in your life, and find a way to use that to grow with.
And then we come to my good teacher. One of the longtime teachers at SMU was a fellow by the name of Jack Clay. And he taught comedy, he taught period styles, he taught Shakespeare, he taught Shaw. A real theater historian as well as a great, great teacher. I was in period styles class. We were supposed to have a song prepared, and I was so depressed at this point of no one ever calling on me, I didn't bust my hump to get a song ready. And it goes, Tobo, get up and do your song. It was the first time I'd been called on all semester. I was like, I got up and I stumbled my way. He says, stop, stop, stop. Never come to this class unprepared again. And the next day he called on me. And the next day he called on me, and the next day. And he didn't give me twice as much work as the other students, three times as much work. He called on me sometimes. He had me in two or three scenes at one time. And Jack Clay believed in me and pulled me out of the valley of despair. Very important.
Surrender yourself to the art, to the teacher. And that doesn't mean that you turn over your life to the teacher. You don't want a guru. You have to keep the autonomy within yourself. You are finally the ultimate authority on your own practice.
I've got teachers for everything. I've gone out and got myself. People have been down the road, whether it be in business or patent work or legal work or in guitar making or machinery work or being a machinist or molding or you name it. I can name you somebody that's a teacher for me in that regard, because that's one thing I got right. I knew that if I tried to do it by myself without input, I was a dead man.
I didn't think much about the music and what it meant to others, only to myself until, I guess the 60s and the 70s, I started hearing groups, especially British groups, saying that they had listened to me and others. And I remember one thing that really knocked me on my feet. I was reading an interview with John Lennon. Someone was interviewing me, and the interviewer asked him, what is it that you haven't done that you'd like to do? He said, play guitar like B.B. King. And I thought, I don't believe this. John Lennon? You know, and from that time I started to pay a little more attention. And now it's quite often I hear people playing that don't maybe even know me, that have listened to somebody else that have listened to me, and I hear it quite often.
That's really wonderful.
I never mention it, but I smile.
B.B. King inspired the first guy in Tijuana, and then I saw him. I am a child of B.B. King.
Now here is the key. You want to make it real and present in the realm of your consciousness. In other words, it's already happened.
Let's just say I wanted to lose some weight. I never worry about that. But let's just say I wanted to lose some weight. I would take a picture of a slim woman, like the body that I want to have, and put, you know, I am now thin. So basically you think in the present. You don't wish, you know, I want to do this. It is. So that's why I said, you know, when I go to my castings, I already see myself as doing the job.
People were laughing at me the last day of school, when they said, well, what are you going to do, man? I said, I'm going to hang out with B.B. King and Michael Bloomfield and Eric Clapton. And people go, pfft. They actually started laughing at me, like, wow, man, you're really, really, like, tripping. I go, no, you're tripping. Because, see, that's all I'm going to do.
I mean, you just had that picture.
And I knew, I mean, I didn't care if a whole school would have laughed at me. I would have said, go ahead, laugh, but I'll show you. That for me, it's about as natural as doing this, look, with my eyes closed. Because I just felt that I'm not an accident.
What do we really intend? And a lot of that is mental. A lot of that is imaging and so forth.
When I'm dropping into a pipe, I know exactly what run I'm going to do, exactly what trick I'm going to do, and exactly what order and how they're going to be done and what grab I'm going to be doing where. And so definitely before I'm dropping in, I'm knowing exactly what I'm having trouble with that day and what I need to work on and what I need to remember and how I'm going to do it and how it's going to look in the air and how I'm going to land in order to have enough speed to hit the next wall. And yeah, so it's super precise in my head. It's exactly, visualization is key for what I do.
I kind of have a notion of where I want to take it, but it's not like a final blueprint. I don't actually really know. And quite often the notion is pretty fuzzy, I mean, really. It's like I just have a general feel for what direction I want to take things in. And then actually sitting down in front of a computer, 99.9% of the work ends up being small, small details.
Now, is consciousness real? Or not real? Well, that's not real. That's just in your mind. Wait a minute. Does it exist in the universe? Does your consciousness exist in the universe? It exists and it's very powerful. And then the idea is to have this mesh between your consciousness, your visualization, and the so-called material world.
I visualized my husband before I met him. I visualized my daughter before I even met him, you know, and I visualized success in my business very specifically, but this is how I visualize. I visualize exactly as if it's happening now. Not like this is what I'd like to see happen, but I literally, it's kind of put myself in a meditative state And I actually see it exactly the way I want it to go down. And pretty much goes down precisely the way I've envisioned it. But not, again, it's the way you visualize is very important. You can't visualize from a point of view of this is what I'd like to have happen, because what you've just visualized that you like to have that happen. And that's true. You want that to happen. So you've come through. But you have to visualize it if it's a done deal.
And where visualization helps in terms of an actor or in terms of a musician is for that audition, for that moment when you're in the room and you visualize every possible circumstance you can be in that room. You work on it standing up, you work on it sitting down. You work on it with your face next to the wall like this, where you're hearing your voice coming back to you. You try to work on it in the car, where the sound is different and quiet. You try to work on it on a walk. The more you are prepared, the luckier you'll get.
A lot of people thought I wasn't gonna be able to pull this off. And I think it very gently and very powerfully pissed me off. No, I can do this. No, you watch. You know, I think there was some of that. I think that, but even more important was that I had had a moment that I realized that I didn't want to go to my deathbed and say I coulda. I wanted to go to my deathbed and said I gave it everything I had. If I failed, at least I could say I tried. It seemed to me a life of pain, and be able to go to my deathbed and say I pulled it off would be much better than a life of non-pain and then going to the deathbed and going, I don't like the way this turned out. Bad news, real bad news.
Absolutely do not try to visualize what your performance will look like. That is none of your business. You should not say, at this point, I'm going to do this. At this point, I'm going to get angry and I'm going to point at him like this. Don't visualize that stuff, because that stuff is pure BS. That stuff is not literature. But what you do try to visualize is what the truth of each moment is. And however it comes out in the room, it comes out that way.
A musician, all it needs is your imagination, and then you channel the inner stuff into some resonance that make your hair stand up. You start crying, and you know, you let go of problems and worries, and you know, like, excuse me, I can't talk to you right now. This is my song.
You really have to learn how to focus in on what it takes for you to shoot one good shot. And I don't try and think about, you know, my next 10 shots to come. I don't think about my last 5 shots. You know, just focus on what it would take for me to shoot one good shot. And I had a very specific routine to do that. So I just filled my mind with that. It was kind of a checklist as well as a very specific image, again, of what I wanted my sights to look like and being inside the ten ring.
There is that human striving for self-transcending. It's part of what makes us human, with all of our flaws and everything else. We want to go a little further than we've ever gone before, and maybe even further than anyone else has gone before. And so we want to play the edge.
Every time I've moved up in this business, it's because I've been so pissed off in a bathroom stall, crying, and I get out and I think, fuck you! And I pick up the phone and I make that call that I've been putting off. And next thing you know, I'm up another level.
Wow.
Never fails.
Wow.
You know how in those times in your life when you say, where did that come from? You know, like, I can't believe I just did that. Well, that has to be inspired in your acting, too. We have to see that. That has to look like this is the first time and the most high-stake time this has ever happened to you.
Notice how, like, when you are in a high-stake situation of any kind, whether it's a high state of seduction or anger, everything else seems to disappear, and you just become very focused in gaining whatever your goal is.
Comfort is the enemy of the artist. If you find that you are in a situation where you are comfortable, you're doing something wrong.
Tracy Wilkins, live in Northeast.
And with all this winter weather on the way, News 4 has some tips to help keep you safe and secure. Layers
in
of
television, the first thing you do when you go in as a neophyte in radio or TV news is you go in armor because you're so frightened and you don't know what you're doing. And letting the armor down, I think the most daring thing you can do in TV news, and I think the same thing occurs in acting, which is why there's this, why it works for me, is to reveal yourself.
Kind of? No.
Come on, like a little date rape?
Like a little date rape? What the?
Did you kind of force her to have sex with you?
I said no.
I can teach work, how to be a hard worker, risk-taking. I've gotten people who were meek people and taking great risks, but it's that thing about really wanting to expose yourself and face down your truths. Your ugly truths, that's the stuff that stops people from being big stars.
You let down your walls. You don't go into something, you know, like this. You can't, you have to completely expose yourself in your writing, in everything. In order to be creative, you have to completely expose yourself.
We're pretty much all incompetent at almost everything we do, and then my fame is because I just end up being very interested in something, and I just took it a lot further than anybody sane would ever have done.
One thing that I find so fascinating about shooting is that it's at this level 99% mental.
The mental aspect is incredibly important. I know a lot of kayakers that are physically as good as I am, and then when it comes to the Olympic trials or the national team trials, the Olympics, they don't perform at the level that they can perform at. And I've always been lucky in that when I come to a big race, no matter how nervous I am, no matter how much I hate the pressure situation, I paddle as well as I do in practice.
And I could shoot better in competition than I did in practice. So I was always stepping a little bit further than what I believed I could accomplish. And so when I'd go in practice and I'd shoot as good as I could, it was always so exciting to go to competition because I always knew competition was going to bring out the best in me.
What is this thing, Paul? What is this thing meant to do? What is this gonna be? What am I gonna do? And I literally remember the moment I decided to crank it up to levels unknown. Now, that was I was gonna crank it up and go for it. And I wasn't gonna stop. And I remember we used to work 7 days a week in the old shop. And it was a big day when John Ingram finally convinced me, he was my assistant at the time, to take Sundays off.
You think about what that character's greatest fear is, and you think about what that character's greatest hope or dream is, and it's like the wheels of a car, right, left, between the greatest fear and the greatest hope, and you try to keep on the road. You take a look at, like, for the way I worked on Ned Ryerson. His greatest fear is that he would not be remembered.
Ned Ryerson! Needle Nose Ned, Ned the Head, come on, buddy, Case Western High!
His greatest hope is that he's a great insurance guy, he will be remembered, and he will sell insurance.
I sell insurance.
What a shock.
Do you have life insurance? Because if you do, you could always use a little more. Am I right?
And in any particular scene, you see how that formula applies to who you're talking to. Is this person someone I'm more afraid of, or is this person can give me something that I hope for? And what are the stakes? Usually the biggest mistake actors make is their stakes are too low. You got to turn up the volume a little bit in terms of your greatest fear or your greatest hope. And when you can express what that is in a sentence, you know what you're doing.
When Hallie first was up for the part of Monster's Ball, they didn't want her.
They didn't think, they thought she was too pretty. They thought she didn't have the talent or the life experience to play this kind of a character. And so through a set of, you know, like pulling in favors and stuff like that, her people got her in for what was really a charity meet. And I told her that she needed to go in there not only as the character, but as a powerful, because the character is like someone that could be in your face, someone who was, you know, kind of an edgy kind of woman. And I said that I also want you to, like, we're going to do this twofold. You're going to be Letitia, which is the lead character in Monsters Ball, but you're also going to go in there and really be a, such a powerful force that they're not going to be able to say no. It will cease to be a charity meet, and it is going to be something that they couldn't live without you. So I want you to go in there, and I want you to tell them, and I want you to use motherfucker and every other word. You motherfuckers are the losers if you don't motherfucking use me, because I'm the best motherfucking person for this motherfucking job. And so she did that. She was in their face, and it was coming from that place of belief in herself, because I was also pumping her up. Because we did this on the foot, told her to do all this. And I was pumping her up, and you could do it, and like, fuck them. It's like they're the ones that are going to be the losers in this, and I want you to fucking tell them that. And I want you to use strong expletives, because you make your point that way. And so she did, and you know the rest of the story.
Each of us potentially is a genius. Each of us is unique in the entire universe. Each of us is more complex, more highly organized, more beautifully organized than the entire physical known universe.
There was a time I felt like Roger Clemens, you know, and or Pedro Martinez, and you are just throwing 106 mile an hour fastball right down the middle. You don't even have to go to the breaking ball because they can't hit the fastball. You can keep it in the back, yeah. And what happens when you're in that zone is you start to feel like, oh God, how long will this last? And then the terror starts creeping in. It's like dreams you have where you're flying, and you're going, this is so great. Wait a minute. I don't know how to fly. Oh, no.
Ah. Guitars are just tools to play music on. That's all they are. It's not that important to the world, but I can tell you that Carlos Santana calls me every Christmas and says, thank you, because you made my job easier this year.
This day, when I receive a new guitar from him, you know, I open it up and I smell the case and I look at it. It's amazing. I'm not making it up. They always arrive in tune. It's an extension of me now. I don't have to do anything other than just transmit.
Yeah, there's definitely been times when I felt like there would be no stopping me, when I felt like I could do anything that you wanted me to do. And I don't mean that in a cocky way. I just mean for the sense that when so many puzzle pieces fall together, you just feel like you're on top of the world when so many of your goals are coming together at the same time, and you're having fun doing it. You know, I just think that if you're reaching your goals, you're having fun doing something you love, there's not really stopping anybody.
There's nothing more tragic to me, and this happened to me once, to talk to an old person at the approach of death, and this older person said, I realize now I've wasted my life. It's very sad. So I think that I really believe that a great deal of neurosis, dis-ease, unease, uneasiness, nervousness, drug abuse, crime, and perhaps even war can be attributed to the failure of developing our potential. I think it is a matter of the utmost importance.
first audition I had was to be the original Ronald McDonald for McDonald's. And I'd never had an audition before. I was in college and they said, go for it, man, you're funny. You be a clown. And I went in on that first interview. And so he says, so Stephen, what can you bring to Ronald McDonald? And I said, well, I don't really know Ronald's character yet. I don't really know what motivates him. But I know one thing. He is a clown. He is a clown. And as a clown, he's probably deeply steeped in comic tradition. I have just taken a course in Italian Commedia dell'arte. I've taken a course in period styles from Shaw to Sheridan to Noel Coward, even to the farce of Molière. So, yes, I would say I'm well-versed in comedy. Pause. Stephen, can you do hand puppets or balloon animals? No, sir. But I'm sure I could learn balloon animals. I've blown before. I can do a giraffe. I'm sure I could. Last question, Stephen. Can you take the stage? I had never really bragged about myself in life, but I thought, maybe you're supposed to in an audition and go, can I take the stage? Can I take this? Let me tell you. Yes, sir. When I am on stage, I am a beam of light. For want of a better word, I have what they call charisma. Can I take the stage? Yes, sir. I take, even the little parts I've played, the reviewers have noticed. They said my intendant in Camus' Caligula was played with verve. Yes, I can take the stage. Pause. No, Stephen. Do you have a trailer hitch? Can you take the stage?